Hi, I'm Bruce Melnick. I'm a veteran space shuttle astronaut. I flew around the Earth 207 times. It took me 310 hours to do it. And I'm here to answer the questions that you sent in on the BBC Newsround website. What we use on the space shuttle or spaceship, we don't use running water because you can't run water in zero gravity. What we use instead of water is a partial vacuum. So you have this little suction like a vacuum cleaner. And so if you have to go number one or pee, you go ahead and pee into this hose that is connected to a little bit of a vacuum, and it goes into a tank that once the tank gets filled, we actually spray it out the side of the space shuttle. And it looks like snow when it comes out the side of the space shuttle. But if you have to sit down and go to the bathroom and go number two, that's a little bit different. You sit on what looks just like a toilet, and you do your business in that toilet. And inside that toilet, it spins around and gets the liquid out of your waste. And that, again, goes in the same wet waste tank that makes the yellow snow. And then the solids that remain, we bring that back down to Earth to be disposed of. Well, it changes. When you first take off, it's very, very rough and very, very loud, and you shake and you rock and roll. But then when the solid rocket boosters come off and you go into second stage, it gets real smooth and real quiet. But now you start accelerating faster and faster, and the G's put you back in your seat and to the point where you weigh three times what you weigh on Earth. And for the last couple minutes of your ascent into space, it gets a little hard to breathe, a little hard to talk. But then when you finally get to space and you run out of gas, you come to what we call main engine cutoff, and instantaneously, like a split second, you go from being pushed back in your seat to poof, zero gravity, and you're just free floating around and get to look at the beautiful Earth down below you. Once you are up there, now you can just move about inside the spaceship by just pushing yourself off one wall to another wall. Very effortless, but you have to be careful, because if you push yourself too fast, you'll bang into another wall. When you want to pass something to another person, you can't just throw it to them, because it just keeps on going and doesn't slow down, and it doesn't fall because you're in zero gravity. So if I wanted to throw you like a piece of food, I could just push it to you and you would just grab it very softly. It's very, very easy. We have very simple foods up there. We bring foods up that we either add water to and they swell up back to their normal shape, or we bring up foods that are already prepared. And those foods we can either heat up in our little oven that we have there, but there's no refrigeration on a space shuttle. And if it's something you wanted to chill, like shrimp cocktail or prawn cocktail, one of my favorites, you would Velcro it to an air conditioning vent to cool it down. And then when you're ready to eat, think about it. You can't cut things with a knife and fork up there because you'd be chasing it in zero gravity. So all we ever use to eat is with a spoon. So you open the little container that your food comes in and you scoop it out with a spoon. And here's what's really cool. In zero gravity, you can let go of that spoon and it'll just float there. And if you have soup or food on it, it's called surface tension, holds that food right to your spoon and it'll float around and you can just grab it and then eat it off the spoon. But you can't spill anything because there's no gravity, so there's no way to spill it. It just stays right where you leave it. Nothing beats looking out the window and looking down to Earth, and it only takes you an hour and a half to go around the Earth. So every 45 minutes you're seeing a sunrise or a sunset. The sunsets were spectacular, but the sun goes down so fast. That's one of my favorite views. And then looking down at the Earth, I think one of the most beautiful places on the planet is the Bahama Islands off of Florida in the United States. Well, I was alive when Alan Shepard flew in space for the first time. I was 11 years old. So that was my first inspiration. And then there was my mom, who encouraged me to do the best I could in school, and I could be anything I wanted to be, and I eventually became an astronaut. It was one of the highlights of my life. I got a call from NASA and they said, how would you like to come and join us and fly on the space shuttle? And I was so excited I had to go back and tell all my colleagues that I was working with that I was going to get to go to space. It takes at least 3 years of training before you can finally go into space, and the training isn't just about flying in space. You have to be an expert on photography and meteorology and oceanography and botany and biology, all these different subjects, because you never know what you're going to do when you're flying in space. My favorite, though, was flying in what we used to call the Vomit Comet. It was an airplane where you could fly and experience zero gravity for 20 or 30 seconds at a time. It was great, but it made a lot of people sick. Well, I actually flew on two space shuttle missions, and both of those missions, we orbited the Earth and we deployed a satellite. We sent a satellite to the Sun on my first mission. And the second mission I was on, we had to do an engine change on a satellite while we were traveling at over 28,000 kilometers per hour. Well, quite frankly, everything that you take into space is essential, except for maybe a couple little gifts you might take back for your family. But when you're in space, the types of things that you miss are pizza, hamburgers, taking a shower, and being able to talk to your family. But usually you only take essential things to space. Back when I was flying in the space shuttle, we didn't have that capability. We could talk to the ground via a video camera, but we rarely talked to our family. The only time we ever talked to our family on my flights was when one of our astronauts' wives had a birthday and we sang happy birthday to her over the video camera. Now on the International Space Station, they can text people, they can chat on internet, and they actually can talk to their families on occasion. They set up special times for that. We adjust our own temperature just like you do at home. And we have a commander on the space shuttle, and he's the boss. So if he likes it hot, he keeps it hot. If he likes it cold, he keeps it cold. But he's the one that tells you what temperature to set on your thermostat in the space shuttle. I don't think it's going to happen in the next 10 years, but probably in the next 20 or 30, you'll see people landing on Mars. Wow, you guys asked some great questions today. I hope you follow your passion and are inspired to be that next generation of our future astronauts. Good luck with that.